When you look at a map, what do you see? A collection of countries and states? Places you've lived, been, or yearn to visit? What images are conjured in your mind? Beaches, mountains, oceans, jungles? Amidst all the wonder and beauty the map inspires, do you see a game? The potential for competition? For speedrunning? Well, even if you don't, others do. In fact, one of the most popular games to speedrun, Cetera, is based on maps of our world. These speedrunners compete to see who can mark or name everything in a geographical space the fastest, whether that be every state in the US, entire continents like Europe or Asia, or maybe just the Great Lakes. A lot goes into a successful speedrunner geography. One must have a strong knowledge of the space they are defining, they must react quickly as a random state or country is assigned for them to place, and they must accurately pin or spell the country with no mistakes. It is no small feat to speedrun geography, and in this video, we're going to explore how to do it and what it means to do so. Here is your crash course on how Cetera works as a game. The player is given a map of a place, let's take the United States for example. They are given a specific state, like Maryland, and need to click on it. The moment they do, another place is randomly named, like Arizona, and they must click on that. They continue until they have clicked on every state, at which point the game is finished. Cetera doesn't necessarily bill itself as a speedrunning game, but as a learning tool. Most games are not made for speedrunning either, but then again, most aren't made from real-world maps or have links to speedrun.com in their sidebar. An entire section of the website's frequently asked questions is devoted to answering questions from educators who may want to use the game to teach their students geography. Typically, as a teacher myself, I'm wary of attempts to gamify the classroom, but as a tool for learning geography, I must admit Cetera is incredibly effective. The game rewards the player for their knowledge and doesn't punish them too harshly for a wrong guess. It gently guides the player toward the correct option and makes it exceptionally easy to keep trying until you've got all the answers down pat. I hate to sound like an old hag, but back when I was a youngster, we would just make flashcards to learn things like this. In a way, Cetera is an evolution of the flashcard. It uses randomized quiz questions as a casual form of test preparation. Essentially, Cetera is a test of the user's knowledge. Knowledge, though, isn't what's being tested when someone sits down to speedrun Cetera. Instead, it is their ability to quickly put that knowledge to use. But the first step towards kinetic proficiency is geographic mastery. Map knowledge is often a shorthand for intellect. It is often what people reach for when trying to insult the intelligence of someone else, particularly an ignorant foreigner like an American visiting Germany or something like that. I will be the first to admit my own ignorance. Just to embarrass myself, I recorded my first blind attempt to beat Cetera's Europe map. I was awful, only getting 45% of the answers correct. I will only defend myself on Italy, where I accidentally misclicked the Vatican without even knowing it was there. Otherwise, I gotta own up to the fact that my foreign geography skills are terrible. What's worse, I've been to some of these countries. Sure, I was only like 7 or 8 years old at the time, but I've seen Austria and the Czech Republic in the flesh, and I still got them confused like a knob. The simple fact of the matter is that most of us only know our immediate regional surroundings and some other important, read large and in charge, places across the globe. I literally took classes and made friends with Tajik students 6 years ago, and they taught me where their country was, and I still didn't get it on my first guess. You might think, well, error, you must be terrible at geography, but I don't think that's the case. I got every US state right on my first run. I know those because I've been to almost everyone, moreover, in a car without GPS, so I actually had to learn the maps just to get from point A to point B. I haven't been to most other places in the world, haven't needed to know where things were. I suspect most people haven't, and as a result, we tend to be ignorant of knowledge that simply doesn't affect our daily life. The average Nebraskan doesn't need to know where Bulgaria is, just like how the average Bulgarian doesn't need to know where Nebraska is. So that knowledge, even if picked up once long ago, is likely to fade away. Still, it feels awesome to actually learn where these places are, and Cetera makes such learning easy and fun. It's so rewarding to go from a place of where is North Macedonia to knowing it so intuitively you can point it out within a second of being prompted. It's almost too good to be true. I keep wondering if after a day or two away from speedrunning, all that knowledge will just fall out of my brain and I'll forget it. but so far, I haven't. That's the beautiful thing about speedrunning Cetera. Because it's constantly giving the player test-like conditions for learning the maps in front of them, the player learns quickly the maps they are studying, much quicker than if they were just trying to memorize a globe. A simple example of this for me is Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan, which I could not locate on a map a month ago. But since I am eager to get them right as I'm learning to speedrun, I have internalized their general location, knowing that Uzbekistan is the northern one and Turkmenistan is the southern one. Now I can point them out without fail most of the time. One of the questions I had when I started drafting this video was, is Cetera a good way to learn geography at all? And in my experience, the answer to that question is a resounding yes. But learning geography is only the first step. In order to speedrun it well, we're going to have to jump through some additional hoops. The first of these hoops is going to be which map you're going to run and how you are going to run it. There are many, many maps on Cetera one can play, but not all are as contested as the primary locales. The main players are the ones with over 100 submitted runs, like any given continent, the US states, or if you want a daunting challenge, the 193 UN member states. I made the US states and every continent the maps I would learn in earnest for this video, attempting and succeeding to best each one in a minute or less. After you select an area of the world to profile, you've got to choose your personal method of cataloging it. First up is PIN, which is as close to a standard run of Cetera as you can get. This is the mode we've been talking about up until this point. Here you are given a place at random and must click on its location on the map. In PIN Hard, the location fades back to green after you do, so you can't easily tell which countries you've already marked and which you haven't. Based on the fastest times in each category, Hard Mode does exactly what it says, which is slow down the user a bit. In Normal PIN Mode, the player can start to process of elimination their way through the game. Even though they already know where all these places are, they can have a better idea of what is coming next. In Hard Mode, because everything's invisible, that's trickier. The biggest genre difference, though, is between PIN and Type. In Type, you don't click on a state, but type out its name and hit Enter. It takes longer to type out a place's name than to just click on its location, but that doesn't necessarily mean that Type is more difficult than PIN. In essence, Type and PIN test different kinds of knowledge. PIN taxes your mouse dexterity, reaction skills, and geography knowledge. Type relies more on the user's ability to spell well, type fast, and recognize a place. There is a difference between being told, click Kuwait, and being shown Kuwait, and being asked, which country is this? It may be subtle, but it really feels like they use different centers of the brain. It is often quicker and easier for your mind to react to the image of a place and spout off its name than it is for you to be given the name of a place and point to it on a map. The map, especially unfilled, can be imposing, causing pauses and mental lapses. Finally, in Text Easy, the runner simply needs to type out all the states in any order they want, which basically removes reaction as a measure of skill. I like both of these genres about equally in concept. In practice, I'm better at Type, but like PIN more. The reason for me is simple. Type feels like a walk in the park. It is more leisurely because my mind rests while I'm typing out the name of Wyoming, but my thoughts have no such luxury when speedrunning PIN. Every click yields another thought, and I'm still consciously thinking as I'm trying to narrowly click on some tiny city-state like Liechtenstein. The Minesweeper speedrunner in me also finds clicking on things just too satisfying, though my tendonitis disagrees, and thus PIN works for me. Regardless of which Cetera speedrun and genre one chooses to pursue, they are going to need good reaction speeds. I would argue that the key difference between a 30-second run of the US and a minute-long one is the speed at which the player can recognize what they must do. It is important to remember that after a short while, any player is going to have proficiency in the factual knowledge of the map. They will know the difference between Slovenia and Slovakia. Thus, speedrunning geography has little to do with knowledge itself. It becomes about how quickly the runner can access that knowledge. Reaction time becomes key because in any given round, the player will need to react with lightning speed. Imagine two players speedrunning the United States. One's average reaction time when being given a new place is half a second, 0.5. The other is 0.6 seconds. Over the course of clicking on all 50 states, the 0.6 second reaction time player will have used 5 more seconds than the other player if everything else remains equal, and that's only a tenth of a second difference between them. Of course, there reaches a point where reaction time can't be lowered, and unfortunately, it is something that we don't fully have control over. But the more you play the game, the faster you'll be able to recognize and move. Your fifth time being told to click on Togo isn't going to be as natural as your 100th. There is one good trick to increasing your reaction time though, which is adding the phrase ?fastclick=1 to the end of your Cetera URL. This will make it so that your clicks go through on press, not release. This makes the haphazard player slightly more error prone, but it means you get your next bit of info a hair faster than you otherwise would. When I turned on fast click mode, I saw an immediate improvement of 2 or 3 seconds, so I highly recommend it for the speedrunner to use. By far the biggest danger to the Cetera speedrunner is the dreaded brain fart. I know that's quite a technical term, we could instead call it a memory lapse, mental stumble, or simply a hiccup. But losing a second or more because you lost your mouse or forgot the location of Singapore is among the worst feelings Cetera can offer. These kinds of pauses are natural for a game that requires perfect recall and 100% of your attention, but minimizing the chances of lapses are key to improving your time. Fortunately, practice makes perfect, and the more you play and encounter new situations, the better you'll be at getting into the flow of speedrunning the game and not needing to pause. This is in part because unlike many other speedrunning games in which the player takes the same path towards the end of the game every time, in Cetera, the ending and starting state are always the same, but the path between them is always randomized. This means that, especially in your first few dozen runs, you're going to be doing certain movements like New York to Wyoming for the first time ever. But you build up an internal memory each time you make a simple connection like that, and soon enough, such transitions are less foreign to you. Movement and accuracy is the other key for the Cetera speedrunner. In type mode, accuracy simply means your ability to type quickly without mistakes, knowing how to spell Kyrgyzstan or Connecticut. In pin, accuracy means your ability to click on the right place on the map quickly. This isn't too hard with no clock, but on a huge map like Asia, clicking on tiny Lebanon or Bhutan becomes a challenge in itself. Even if you intuitively know where they are, the question becomes how quick can you get there? Misclicks are dire in this game, since you need to get 100% to submit a run. This might seem like a bit of a silly requirement. When you're speedrunning most games, 100% is just not required. But Cetera is not a joy to speedrun or watch when someone is just click spamming their way across the map for quicker results. Still, the sad reality is that spamming in such a way is faster for most players than carefully clicking right where they need to. Suffice to say, speedrunning geography becomes a lot more interesting when the player actually needs to be accurate. It reminds me of one of my favorite games to speedrun, Minesweeper, where one false move also spells doom. Just like Minesweeper and most speedrunning games, getting better at Cetera is a slow climb. Where exactly you'll plateau, I couldn't tell you, but after your initial memorization pays off, it's not easy to get better. There really aren't any shortcuts for the player to learn. It's about changing your own mind, reacting ever so faster to the game's shifting circumstances. Each player gets a vision of their top speed, as it were, as they near the end of their journey to accurately map out an area. As the map gets filled in, the options become less, and it becomes easier to predict what's coming next. These moments make the player wonder, what if I could play that fast all the time? That seed of speed often spurs the player to try again, shave some seconds off, internalize the map even further. Finally, I want to comment on something interesting I found as I learned to speedrun Europe. As I've already stated, I was familiar enough with the 50 US states to get them on my first go-around. Meanwhile, I had an atrocious score in Europe. You'd think I'd thus be better at speedrunning the US based on my inbuilt knowledge, but that is strangely not the case. Not only can I run Europe just as fast as I can run the states, but in terms of reaction speed, I tend to run Europe quicker. I think this is specifically because I have less inbuilt associations with Europe. I learned that map for the purpose of speedrunning it, while I learned America's for the purpose of traveling it and probably getting an A on a test. When confronted with American places, a ghost haunts me, if ever so slightly, which causes hiccups in my play. I recall memories from places, see images of a store or natural beauty, hear sounds of people I've met. I could honestly tell you a story about every state in the US, but I can't tell you much about Azerbaijan. There are no ghosts with it, and that makes my ability to recall its location all the more easier. This reality and more leads us to perhaps a more important question than how the heck do you speedrun geography? What the heck does it mean to speedrun geography?
Just as all phenomena exist in time and thus have a history, they also exist in space and have a geography.
The title of this video and this section may have piqued your interest for a reason other than their innate curiosity. Is Soterra an exercise in geography, or wouldn't it be cartography? Cartography is, after all, the study of making and using maps. And isn't the player using a map to play a game when they speedrun Soterra? Yet, I'd argue that the study of cartography is more about the method of making good maps, and less about understanding them or the lands they represent, the people and places that reside on their pages. That latter process is the study of geography, and learning such places is something most people do in geography class. At a glance, this distinction does not seem important. Does it matter if I'm practicing geography or cartography when painstakingly clicking on every country in Asia? I think it does, and in this section, I'm going to try to argue the importance of geography. When one speedruns geography, it is productive that they strip away every detail from that place other than its location and name. Any other facets or histories are extraneous at best. But at its core, the study of geography is not just names and places, but the relationship between those places and people. This is technically human geography, but that's the closest kind of geography to what Soterra is. It's understanding that space impacts who we are. While the knowledge of where a country is on a map does not make one a geographer, it does begin the process of thinking about places' importance and the enormity of our globe. As for Soterra's maps, a savvy observer should probably reckon with the fact that they are deeply influenced by the history of colonialism. The vast majority of our planet was at some point under European control. Imprinted on the maps the Soterra speedrunner plays on is colonialism's legacy, borders of countries divvied up by colonizers with little thought for who lives there. The map of Africa, for instance, cannot be dislodged from the aftermath of colonialism and the Berlin Conference of 1884, where those lands were divided up by people who did not live there or care for who did. Today's national boundaries on the continent depressingly line up almost exactly with the ones drawn up at that conference. Maps are not inherently colonial, and I wouldn't go so far as to say that the speedrunner is reenacting colonialism when they click on the map in a mad dash to claim it, not unlike the mad dash for Africa by European powers, but hopefully the chaotic and unwieldy nature of the continent's map, which is the most difficult one for me to learn and is the slowest times of any continent on the leaderboards, prompts the question, why is this map so complex? Hopefully, that line of questioning brings the player to recognize the deeply historical and arbitrary reason the world map is the way it is. Heck, I hope it helps them understand that Soterra's world map is based off the Mercator projection, which grossly understates the size of lands on the equator, and thus, in some ways, their importance. Just look at these two maps, and you tell me how the constant use of one, whenever someone needs a quick snapshot of our world, might influence its audience's perception of the planet and who lives here. Geopolitical maps come about in part due to natural geography and the way spaces are constructed, perhaps most obviously by the presence of oceans, but also mountains, deserts, lakes, and rivers. But many borders were chosen at times and places after wars or when colonial powers jockeyed for more land and power without the representation of people who lived there. The arbitrariness of these borders is not arbitrary for them, those families, friends, and communities separated by an invisible line. They are real and consequential. Yet, it is those same people, them, you, and everyone you know, who are removed from the equation when speedrunning Soterra. The borders one peruses and dodges while speedrunning should be defined. I am partial to Gloria Anseldúa's description in Borderlands. Borders are set up to define the places that are safe and unsafe, to distinguish us from them. A border is a dividing line, a narrow strip along a steep edge. While Anseldúa's concern is primarily with those who live on or near borders, no matter how far one lives from the dividing line, that line still has a marked impact on their life. I love the description of a narrow strip along a steep edge. A description not just apt for the people who live along the borderland, but for the speedrunner, for whom that steep edge can confer victory or defeat in a single click. Colonial knowledge trickles down into the play context of Soterra. These maps keep zero of the qualities, peoples, or cultures of spaces sanctioned as play object, even though these are the exact things Hansel Dua finds define a border. Even including natural borders like river's notions, borders are invented, built out of conflict, off the back of narratives, in the shadow of history. Already, geographical maps run the risk of neglecting what's actually there, and when gamified, the danger is even higher. Yet, I'd argue the speedrunner is uniquely situated to consider colonialism's impact. On one hand, the map's arbitrariness is the playground of their sport. On the other, it is only because that map denotes real physical space that the allure of knowing it, playing on it, holds attentive power. It's not that someone couldn't or wouldn't speedrun a map of Middle-earth, but such clicking probably couldn't attract an audience and community as broad as Soterra's. That's the point, isn't it? These maps aren't arbitrary for the one who plays them. That's what makes Soterra fun, its closeness with real-world geography. But does that proximity bring the world closer together? It's hard to say. If you follow a colonial mindset, as in thinking of the map as a place to explore and conquer, then the world has been getting closer together by matter of knowledge and transportation speed. At some point in the past, there was a mystery to the world. The map was not totalizing. But now, especially with the advent of GPS, the lands of Earth can be plotted and traversed with relative ease. Hannah Arendt writes in The Human Condition,
"Precisely when the immensity of available space on Earth was discovered, the famous shrinkage of the globe began. Until eventually, in our world, each man is as much an inhabitant of the Earth as he is an inhabitant of his country. Men now live in an Earth-wide, continuous whole, where even the notion of distance, still inherent in the most perfectly unbroken contiguity of parts, has yielded before the onslaught of speed. Speed has conquered space."
I hate to disagree with a thinker as fantastic as Arendt, but speed has not actually conquered space. Speed has conquered the idea of space. Space is still there. It separates the Yemeni from the Swede, the Chinese from the Nigerian. Even in the age of the internet, where the speed of global conversation is practically instantaneous, it is proximity which reigns. Most people's beliefs and ideals, friends and family, are based on where they are from, and for good reason. Space matters. Soterra reinforces this in its rigid interaction with global maps, not displaying what could be, but what is. Yet, what is can and does change. As I was writing this video, the Asian map was updated to change the Afghan flag in response to the Taliban's takeover of that country. In 2011, South Sudan became its own country. In 2008, Kosovo did the same. In 2006, Serbia and Montenegro split in two. I deeply admire Soterra's developer and owner, Marianne Wartoff's, commitment to keeping the game's maps up to date. It reflects a crucial understanding of the practice of geography. The world is constantly shifting under our feet. Whether in the glacial pace of continents drifting apart, the melting of ice caps and subsequent rising sea levels deleting ocean shores, or the comparatively rapid way us humans tend to demarcate who owns what in each space, these changes impact geography dramatically. It is practically impossible to keep up with a world of geographically significant changes, but the Soterra speedrunner gets a glimpse, a starting point toward understanding the profound realities that outline our world. And that, to me at least, is a more profound notion of speed than the one Arendt dreamt of. In some ways, you'll always remain ignorant of things in this world. This is in part because the more you know about something, the more you know you don't know. I did not know Seychelles was a country off the coast of Africa before beginning this project, so now there are only more questions regarding its geography, who lives there, and what they're like. The goalposts of knowing are always moving, always shifting under our feet, just like how maps are not static but fluid. Knowledge can be zoomed in or zoomed out. But what Soterra does beautifully, and how it resists that colonial logic, is in how it gives the user a taste. A road they could go down, a path toward more knowledge. Sure, within its programs and ludic structure, it is little more than a memorization game, but in its practice, in its attempt to display the world to the player, It points them in the direction of understanding our small blue dot and says, go, learn. And that's as good of a start as you can get, at least while sitting in front of your computer. I'm Error, slightly better at geography now, signing off.